Okay, you're out. All right, so let's start. Next up, we got Florian and Fabian. Showing us why websites are dead, and I'm pretty curious. So let's get on.
Good.
Give it up.
So welcome everybody, and nice that you're here. We want to talk today about websites are dead, long live the websites, and give you a short update on a few things we're thinking about the last couple of weeks. So my name is Florian Franke. I'm an interactive designer at my own digital agency in Frankfurt. It's called Made In. It's called Made In, yeah. And we're working for different clients, large and small. We have we're doing a lot of work for Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung, as well as for Subaru, but also smaller clients like small psychological or psychoanalysts websites, etc., and also brand work. And my position in the office is like the interactive designer, so I'm doing a lot of interactive concepts, strategies, as well as app design, web design, and digital magazines. So that's where my interest is in. Closely connected to this, I wrote a book with a friend of mine from Berlin. It deals about apps with HTML5, CSS3, and JavaScript, because I think if you want to be a digital designer, it's also very important to know the technical side of stuff a little bit more. So that was quite interesting. We started writing that, I think, 3 or 4 years ago, so times changed until now, but nevertheless still interesting for me to work in that kind of field.
Yeah, welcome from me as well. My name is Fabian Stein. I work for Punkt.de, and there I do the sales and marketing stuff. Punkt.de is an, most of you will know, a type of three web agency. We're doing mostly type of three and NEOS projects in the enterprise section, so really big projects. And besides of that, I'm a leader of the type of three marketing team and the type of three design team, so I'm doing a lot of communication stuff and caring about these communication and channels and so on. Okay, so the question is, websites are dead. Why do we go to work? Most of you might go to work for the same thing. To make it somehow easier for us, who's designer in the room?
Oh, quite a few, actually.
That's good. Okay. Who's a developer? Okay. Who's CEO?
And who's marketing expert or something with marketing? All right.
Okay.
Cool.
Thank you. Okay. We want to show you today why websites are dead, and why they are so sad that they not get in pyramid. We want to talk to you today at first about questioning the internet. Where do we, or who do we question? Where do we get our answers from? Then we will meet an old friend of us. Probably some of you have used it long ago. We meet Dreamweaver, and
who knows Dreamweaver?
that's
nice. That's
it. Okay, and after that we will go over platform and where is information going today and in the future. What are our users expect from us, the clients and the users from the clients, and at the end we will go over where does this innovation leads us to. So Florian will start with the question.
Yeah, question. So first things first, I'm really looking forward to this talk today, to be honest, because I think it's always a lot of fun, and I'm curious about your questions at the end, or what you will take from this talk. So please get in touch with us after the talk to give us some feedback. That would be great. So thank you for that. So our first thing today would be a question. So we ask ourselves, what do we really as users expect from the internet, or what should websites or et cetera things we look up should do for us? And well, in a lot of cases where we're using the internet as a general, we have a question like, what's the weather today? What's the weather in Munich? Or how do I get from there to this? Or what's the best XYZ, et cetera? And to be honest, for answers, we don't need really websites, right? Because if we want to get an answer, then we want that answer, and we don't want to read thousands of pages to find that answer. So possible answers today would be, what's the capital of Ghana? How tall is Angelina Jolie? How did Bayern Munich do yesterday? So all the important stuff of life. I think Bayern Munich did quite well in the last couple of days. Are there some fans here? Any more fans of Bayern Munich? All right, okay. You're scared to show yourself, right? Yeah. Okay, so in the end, we think we want answers and not websites in the end, right? So in the past, we could say the answer was buried in a website. Eh? We had to dig it out ourselves. So if we did a Google search for, okay, where do I get the best beer? Then maybe Google or every other search engine plots out a few websites where maybe I can find that answer. I have to press here. And then I have to look at the website and see where can I find that info. Is that information correct? Is it not correct? I don't know. The world's best beer is 2016. World's best lager is maybe Hausen Bier Dunkel. Hausen, Patrick. His last name is Hausen, so that's the gag. Anybody tried Hausen Bier Dunkel? All right, okay, then we'll not find out today. But that's how things were in the past, right? We searched for something, and then we have to dig through websites and see, okay, where is this information hidden, etc. So today, things have changed a little bit, right? So the answer is maybe buried in a website, but Google or other systems can answer it right away. And that's a pretty neat thing if you think about it, because you don't have to dig through websites that deep or you don't have to put a lot of effort to find or to get your answers to questions. So if we ask Google, what's the capital of Ghana? Yeah, we don't see the website or Wikipedia, we just see the answer. So it's Accra or Accra. And that's the thing where users don't even get to the website in the end. So in the future, we could say some kind of artificial intelligence presents the answer and related action, and the website is actually buried. It could look like this. So after what's the capital of Ghana, it could show me the area, the weather, local time, and maybe related actions which could be interesting, like I could plan a trip, etc. I could take a look at hotels, etc., or points of interest. And the truth is that, yeah, that's not the future, that's today, right? So all of this stuff, Google is already doing this. And they're doing this with what they call knowledge graph. And the knowledge graph is some kind of semantic or is a way to connect information and data and facts from the web and try to make a meaning out of it, so it can really answer these kind of questions and also related actions and points of interest and whatsoever. And if you go to Google's website and search for knowledge graph, then you get a nice fancy promo page of them where they read, when you search, you're not just looking for a web page, yeah? You're looking to get answers, understand, and explore. And this is how they're visualizing their knowledge graph thing. And these small little info panels which pops out on the right of your search results or this Accra thing, they call it knowledge panels. So this is where they present their information which is stored in the knowledge graph and which evolves every year or every time people search for something or put new content on. And there are different kind of knowledge panels, and I think it's interesting to get an overview, okay, what's out there. So there's a knowledge panel for companies. So if you type in Lufthansa, you get basic information. Thank you, Fabian. Basic information about the Lufthansa, you get the stock price, technical support. So it assumes that you have a problem with your flight, so it maybe displays also the phone number for the technical support as well as track flight status, etc. So it's not just the company info, but even more than that, even today. And you can get the same with prominent or VIP people like Angelina Jolie. So now we know her height; it's 169 meters. You can get the same with restaurants. I think a lot of you already use that feature. So Dacimino is a nice restaurant at our offices right around the corner. So it's pizzeria, and there's reviews, popularity, popular times, etc. And you could also order right away. And we would like to just sink that in for a bit, because we always take it for granted. But if you think about it, it's a lot of data going on and a lot of things which Google processes there, and which are presented to you in a very understandable and easy way. But it doesn't stop there. So there are different knowledge panels, especially for technical questions. Yeah? I think there are a lot of developers in the room. I think you all had to type in some kind of question, developer-related. One of the classics is, OK, how do I center a div block using CSS? OK, not that current maybe anymore, with fluid layouts, or with flex layouts, et cetera. But even here, the data is not pulled from Wikipedia or Google sources, but also from third-party services like the site wizard.com. Never heard of this website, but Google scans the website and presents the answer right on the Google page. And that's tricky, because maybe Site Wizard depends on ad impressions or something like that to get the business going and their website going. But people are never reaching their website. Other knowledge panels may be what people also ask. So this can be gathered by the billions of search queries Google get every day. And also film reviews, critics, et cetera, you name it. And I'm sure there are a lot of more knowledge panels which I haven't found in that first kind of round. And Google just published very current numbers. So in October 2016, they said they have about 70 billion facts in their knowledge graph. And they started in 2012, so that's 4 years and 70 billion facts. That's a lot of facts. And now we would say, okay, Google, okay, but Bing is doing the same thing, and Bing also displays these kind of knowledge panels. They look very similar to Google, actually. So Bill is also happy about that. So it's not just Google who does it, but other services and companies as well. And I really can recommend a Medium channel, and it's called Backchannel.com. It's like an online newspaper or magazine. And they interviewed a few Google technicians and high-profile people there. And they say that Google won't say officially what percentages of queries evoke a knowledge graph answer, but appears comfortable with a ballpark estimate of about 25%. So let that sink in for a moment. 25%. So every fourth query to Google is answered by Google themselves on the web page. So maybe every fourth user which will be on your website is already, or is not coming to your website because Google already answered the question. And I think it's pretty high. And if it's just 20%, then it's also very high. So if we look in the future, maybe we'll just have answers, right? Do we need websites? Or can every question be answered by some kind of knowledge panel? Or if you think about voice, which is a very current topic with the Google Assistant and the new Google Pixel phone, or Siri, or Amazon Alexa, or Wolfram Alpha, will it just be presented by me in a natural language kind of way? So I have a dialogue with this kind of assistant, and it reads me the answer. Because it wouldn't never read me a website, because that's what's the point in reading a website, right? It has to present me the answer right away. So that's about questions.
Okay, as we heard from Florian, there will be a lot of answers be done right by Google, and the more information you get from there, the more important gets the question, how expensive can my website be? And how many money will I put into my website if I run a business? And when I started to think about that and talked a lot to Florian, we were like, okay, we really had a long time trying those website builders or stuff. Website builders are cheap. Website builders are easy to use. And the funny thing about my experience with website builders was that before I started to really making web, I tried those. Who has tried the Dreamweaver really? Okay, who has tried Microsoft Publisher for building a website? Yeah, nice, yeah. me as well. And when I got my first Mac, I was really loving this iWeb tool. Yeah, who has tried this iWeb? Okay, so a few. For those who get a nice feeling about this, I had a short video how hard it was with Dreamweaver to build something.
Gets warm around the heart, you know.
Yeah.
I used to build a website with this 10 years ago.
Yeah. It feels a bit like... Yeah, actually, it's very fast and up, and at the end they have a menu. Yeah, that's actually everything they do right there. So it was really hard to build something with it. But of course they are cheap, and the question is, back in the days we said, okay, it's really easy to convince a client to say, hey, but you don't want such a website. You really want to have a nice shiny website that experience or that express yourself and that somehow fits to you, and individuality is everything. So you see here, that's the idea of individuality is everything. Maybe it is not.
I know.
No, we haven't. So you see that we had to do in here, and we haven't fixed it yet. That are actually numbers from the top one is from Wix. Wix is a website builder from today, and the bottom one is from Weebly. That's the second biggest one worldwide. And if you look at the numbers, there are 90 million users using Wix, and there are already 40 million users using Weebly. So there are a lot of people using those website builders to get their website together and to get their information. And it's increasing. It's increasing a lot. You see here, the registered user, it's with all those website builders, there's a free version where you can make an easy website, and there's the premium version where you can get some more features to that. And you see there are a lot of people using that, so the question is this individuality we try to get really the important thing? When we look at this, probably the most of you have seen such a thing, and we all always think, why is Type 3 not there seeable? And then there's this question with its WordPress. And when I first get this thing, I was like, yeah, nice, those 44% are for us to conquer. today I would say probably not, because when I think about, okay, we saw the numbers, and there are a lot of website building things coming up here, and if we think about that WordPress, probably 70% is made by basic templates from WordPress, and a lot of those is made by website builder or so on. We see that that's not future, that individuality is not everything. We see that it's already there, that there is a lot of basic templating. And I have some numbers here with sites. It's from February of last year, so it's not that actual, but it's still. And you see here, Wix is a website builder, Weebly is a website builder, and Squarespace is even a website builder. And the point is, they are not looking too bad. Actually, I'm not the perfect designer for this. Maybe it's Florian, it's a better. But you can easily click here, put your tour data in it, and if you are a small band, you can just use it. I have put a video up where you see that's Dreamweaver today. Of course, it's not Dreamweaver, but it's Wix, but it's much faster, and you get out a really nice website. I personally tried it for this talk to get a feeling of it, and I made a portfolio for myself, so I put some pictures in it, and it really feels nice. It gets easy, it really feels nice. And the point is, of course, the video I showed you from Dreamweaver was from 2004. In 2004 they said, hey, we built a nice website with it. Okay, now it's 12 years later, and they really do, but they had to take 12 years to get their promise. But there's new stuff coming for us, and I have a sound here, so can I... Because I have a video for you, where we see, don't know, who in the room knows Grid.io? The Grid.io? Okay, a few. The Grid.io is a really nice thought. They're thinking that for those website builders, I still need to have at least somehow a design skill, because I can totally rearrange it, and then it looks bad as well. And I have to click a lot, and I have to think about, okay, will my information fit into this template, or is my information too long or something? And the grid is going one step more, and they say, okay, give us your content, no matter what it is, this is a Twitter stream, a Facebook stream, put your content in by your own, and we will build the website completely by artificial intelligence. So they will put it, and the intelligence will made it by their own.
There are plenty of ways to get a website. Wouldn't it be better if websites just made themselves? Well, they did. It's called the grid. Just tell the grid what you want, and it uses artificial intelligence to build a tailor-made home for your content. Content is power. Power your content on the grid.
Yeah, we looked into this, and actually we tried to do the Typo3 marketing sprint side with it. And it feels a bit like Dreamweaver 2004. So, of course, it's the first draft, and we tried it, and it's not really working right now. But I'm pretty sure that they will not need 12 years to build this up again. When we think about how the technique goes faster and faster, I'm pretty sure that the grid will be able to work much faster than in 12 years. One more thing to the website builders is when I start thinking about this, I actually thought about websites just with information on it, and then I get into those website builders anymore, and I see that there's just more than layout. For my example for this is that there is a booking system that you can get into the Wix. You can do a complete hotel in there, so you can put your junior suite and your standard room in there, and it does even such things like, okay, is it free or is it not free? You can put check-in and check-out there. It's very easy to use with all the room properties you can put in there, and even all the payment connectors are made and so on. And it costs just $9.99 per month. So I was like this, and was wondering, okay, before, yeah, when we started, I thought, oh, you want a news? I have to build up a CMS, because news can never be made by such a website builder. Of course, now news are very easy for everybody. And now they're coming with this hotel stuff, and they were coming with more and more. So a lot of techniques will become more easy and more cheap to use. If we think this one more further, the question is, do I really need this website, or is it maybe just the next thing, the portal information? I don't know how you use those portals, no matter if it's Facebook or Twitter or something, but I have a lot of friends, for them it's like breathing. They not even recognize that they are on those portals, and no matter if they're sitting in the train or wherever, and they always are online and looking for them. And there are millions of them. There are millions of things. Probably you know most of the portals, no matter if it's Facebook, Yelp, LinkedIn, Twitter, Snapchat, anything. And when we look on those Google card Flo showed us today, you see here, for example, those information not just come from their websites. For example, they have here book a table and open table, and the here that information how good the restaurant is comes from open table as well. And that probably is the reason why the website of this very nice restaurant actually looking not that good. So it's
it's like Dreamweaver all over again.
Yeah, it's like Dreamweaver all over again actually. But of course, they have, for example, a TripAdvisor page, because they say, hey, most of the people coming to me are from different cities. They stand around somewhere in Frankfurt and say, I want the next nice Italian restaurant. And then, of course, they will use TripAdvisor. They will never go to their website. don't know how many of you have a known Facebook page, for example. Of course, on other platforms it's the same, but in earlier times it was that, okay, I have a lot of channels, like the Twitter channel and the Facebook channel, and at least I have all information on my site, so if you don't want to go there or go there, I have all information there, and people that are not used so much to the portal can go there. And for us at Punkt.de, for example, was the thing that we, from the start, don't want to have a Facebook site because, I don't really like those Facebook thingy and so on. And we don't have a Facebook site, but still the most hits to our website came from Facebook without having a Facebook site. And then we started, of course, we need a Facebook site. And now I learned that there are a lot of channels in a Facebook site. So, for example, they don't have a website because they say, hey, I have all channels in here, and there are not just Facebook channels. For example, there's a YouTube channel in here as well that is coming right away, and then they have this and then they're having this trip review, what is completely programmed by themselves, and then they say, okay, I have everything in here, and maybe, for example, I need events, and events is totally fine with Facebook. So it's really easy to build up events, and they have to connect to my brand anyway. And so they say, okay, we use the events on our own Facebook site. So it's all about information channels and where does this information go. And like you all know, double information is very hard to catch. And then the question is, oh, have I posted on Twitter or have I posted on Facebook or what happening? And then we're coming back to, from the first start, when the business will do their own stuff, they will start with the channel they are used to. So if the owner of this restaurant likes Facebook, they will start with a Facebook thing. And the longer it goes, and maybe when they get really good feedback to that, then it might be interesting to get tools that help you to organize your channels, no matter if it's Hootsuite or a bigger two, but you can start very lean and very cheap. And with that, we're coming to the next topic, and that's about the expectations of the users, and is that enough for them?
Yeah, so expectations. I wonder if a few of you maybe saw those websites Fabian just presented and maybe thought, especially designers, so nah, doesn't look that good maybe, yeah. But is it really something the user expects at the end, or is it, or does it matter for them anyway? So if we think about expectations, we could see it like this. So maybe the user has a basic expectation about the website and just want to pee in this occasion. And then happens stuff like this, where designers or programmers, etc., build some kind of castle behind the first impression, which maybe isn't necessarily needed. So it's good to ask in regular times, what do people basically expect from a website at the end? So what is it? Is it the answer or something else? So we came up with a few things. Maybe it's not a complete list, but it's a good start, I guess. So maybe people expect instant load. They expect interactivity. It has to be informative. It has to be uniquely designed. It has to be usable on all devices. It has to be structured, consistent, personalized, multimedia-based, regular updated content, etc. Maybe that's all expectations, or these are all expectations which certain people for certain websites have. But if you boil it down, and if you're a bit strict with yourself and just take a step backward, then maybe it's just these four which are the most critical ones. So usable on all devices, informative, structure, and instant load. And especially if we take a look at usable on all devices, is it really an expectation anymore? I think or is it standard? So I think people don't expect it anymore. They just see it as a given fact that it is like that. And if we think about instant loads, then we found this graph on the internet, which reads, I think many of you know what are the performance issues with websites or with users, and it says that after 4 seconds of load time, or at least 4 seconds of load time, 25% of your users are already left. So if your web page doesn't load instantly, you can have the best design in the world, it doesn't matter because people will leave. And I think every one of us knows this by themselves or experienced it by themselves. So we think instant load is a critical thing to meet, as well as informative. If we think about that websites answers questions, then we'll have to ask ourselves, okay, how users read on the web? And Jakob Nielsen, a user interface guru, or he does this for like 25 years or so, he said, all right, okay, how users read on the web? Summary, they don't. People rarely read web pages word by word. Instead, they scan the page, picking out individual words and sentences. So it's not only about a question about the design, but also a question about, okay, how can we structure content? How can we present content in an understandable way? And how can we make an assumption what the question of the user was? Because that's the thing in the end we want to answer. Whoops. So websites, in order to do this, websites has also to be structured, because a confused mind never buys. I think also many of you know that if you search for something on Google and then go to a page and it's very cluttered and unstructured, then you will leave right away because it doesn't answer your question right away. So there's a lot of chit-chat on the web which says, oh, the users expect so much more these days, we have to build all these tools and all these things, etc. And to be honest, in my opinion, I think they expect less than we think. Because we as designers or developers have very high standards for our work, which is a good thing, but I think we also have to take a look at these other developments like website builders, which may look not that polished in the end or not that uniquely designed, but they work for a lot of people and a lot of businesses and a lot of owners and CEOs.
So what does this innovation means for us, or what happens there? I found an example what is a lot older than the web is about the weavers. When the weaving chairs came up, a lot of people that made weaving by hand were like, oh, what the hell, what happens here, and how can I assure that I will buy or will get money in the future? Because the people with the weaving chair were four times faster and they were more precise. So quality was better and it was much faster. And if we think about that's how a weaving machine looks today, of course nobody weaving by hand can compare to that anyhow. But still there are some people that weave by hand, and that's very expensive clothes. We at Puncti had a developer before who was a guitar builder before. And he said, okay, when we start with guitars, they were, for example, from 200 to 1,000 euros. Of course, there are guitars that are much more expensive, but let's take it for the example. And then Aldi came up and built a guitar for like 50 euros. And the problem was that this guitar was as good as those from 200 to 500 euros. And of course, there are still the most expensive guitars that are much nicer and easier to play and whatever, but the basic guitars from 200 to 500 euros just stopped to be built because the guitars for 50 euros are as best as they are. And when he explained that to me, it was like 5 years ago, and I was like, hey, we are in a growing market and websites will be made all the time, and that will not happen to us. And actually it will happen to us, and it happened to all industries on some time, and it's nothing to fear of, it's just something to work with.
So maybe ask yourself, okay, I understand all these things, but what's now? Should I go home? Should I close my shop? Or what should we do in the end, right? So I think we wouldn't want to try to paint like a dystopian thing here. We still think websites are a very special and interesting or important tool in the web in general. But we were hoping, or our goal with this presentation is like to encourage you to look more often left and right, and to look what others are doing, what artificial intelligence are doing, what does these website builders do, in which we are all always saying, ah, come on, there are no, it's like for someone else, but not for me. So we try to sum it up a little bit. So
yeah, to this innovation that happened to all market and all business someday, and we want to make you brave, to stay open and develop your business with it, to just have it in mind and don't be surprised when it hits you.
Yeah, and that's a pretty hard thing for me to say as a designer, but if you think about expectations, maybe your design is not as important as you think, right? So design is very important, yes, because I already also selling this kind of service, but it's important, yes, but as this guitar example from Fabian said, not for every target group, or for a lot of people, a small design or a simple design is enough. And that's something I think we should really remember more than once in a week or so.
Yeah, what we learned about platforms is that many people will never reach your site. And it's important to think about what this means for us. My best example is that I really often go into my PIVIC and say, hey, we have more users on the website, so we are performing good. But the question is will that keep, or is it then, okay, nobody will ever go to my website, and I have to think about, hey, but maybe they get their information from Google by their own, and I haven't tracked that. So we have to think about what this means for us and our business.
Yeah, and I think we should not be naive, because, yeah, questions may not be answered by your website in the end. Maybe they will be answered by you, but not on your website, where your ad impressions or your pivots or analytics or et cetera track them. So, yeah, be realistic.
Small websites will be done by the business themselves. I think that's something that will happen to us sometimes, and there are two things coming. Yeah, the one thing is that the to build a website getting easier and easier, and the other thing is that people running business getting more comfortable with technique as we speak. So there are two things coming together that will totally lead to that small business will make their website or their Facebook channel or whatever themselves.
So to sum it up, we would like to stop building website and start thinking purposes. Think outside the box, think left and right, and thank you.